Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You are welcome to another edition of this online class. You remember in our last class, we discussed about Charles' law, general gas equation, ideal gas equation. Now, let us just remind ourselves again. The Charles' law, we said the volume of a fixed mass of a gas is directly proportional to the temperature at constant pressure. Now, if you look at that diagram, the one I show you on the board, as the volume increases, the temperature also increases and vice versa. Now, reason is because the average kinetic energy is dependent on the temperature. That is, as the temperature increases, the average kinetic energy, which is the energy motion, also increases, and the velocity of this molecule increases. Thereby, they move rapidly, collide with the walls of the container, and exert pressure. Now, if this pressure is kept constant, then the volume must be increased at increasing temperature. That means as the temperature increases, the volume must increase. Also, if the temperature is lower, the kinetic energy of this gas molecule decreases and the velocity will also decrease. So, at constant temperature, the volume must be reduced at a lower temperature. That means when the temperature reduces, the volume will also reduce. That is that. Now, you remember the gas equation where we have the two values for R constant. The one of 8.34 joule per Kelvin per mole. If you remember in the last class, I stopped at 8.314 newton meter per mole per Kelvin. Now, the newton meter is the same thing as joules, and that is why we normally see that value as 8.314 joule per Kelvin per mole. Now, that is that for that class. Now, today's class, we are going to talk about Dalton's law of partial pressure and the Graham's law of diffusion of gases. Let's start with the Dalton law of partial pressure. We state that if we have a mixture of gases that do not react chemically together, the pressure exerted by this mixture is the sum of the partial pressure of the individual gases in the mixture, or that make up the mixture. Now, what we are going to look at there is partial pressure. What is a partial pressure? The partial pressure of a gas is the pressure exerted by the gas when it is alone in a container. That is what is called partial pressure. Now, since these gas do not react together, then the total pressure becomes the pressure of the sum. The pressure of each of the gas that makes up the mixture. Now, using if we have maybe like three gases A, B, C, if you see it on the board, I said P total is equal to P A, that is the partial pressure of A, plus the partial pressure of B, plus the partial pressure of E. Then when we have N mole of gases, then we have P total to be partial pressure of A, partial pressure of B, partial pressure of C. It goes like that up to N, where N is the number of moles of gases. Now, using kinetic theory to explain this Dalton law of partial pressure, you know, we say that at constant temperature, the average kinetic energy is also constant. Now, since the collision between this gas molecule is perfectly elastic, that is, there is no energy loss. Now, the pressure of each of the gas will be the same as if they were alone in a container. Now, that is that for that. Now, if the gas is collected over water, then it must have been wet with water vapor. You know, water vapor is also a gas. It has its own pressure. So the P total will now be the partial pressure of the gas plus the partial pressure of the water vapor. Now, if you are looking for the partial pressure of the gas alone, that is making the partial pressure of the gas the subject of the formula, then we have P gas is equal to P total minus P of the water vapor, minus P of the water vapor. So that is that on that. Now the partial pressure, as we all know, is the product of the mole fraction and the total pressure. That is, if we are not given the partial pressure and we are asked to calculate the partial pressure of an individual gases, we are going to have the number of moles of that gas all over the total number of moles of the gases that are involved multiplied by the total pressure of the gas. Now, we know the number of moles, that is the number of the partial pressure of gas A will now be the number of moles of gas A divided by the number of moles of gas B plus the number of moles of gas the partial pressure of A will now be the number of moles of A all over the number of moles of A plus the number of moles of B plus the number of moles of B multiplied by the P total, that is the total pressure, where NA all over NA plus NB plus NC is called the mole fraction of this gas. Now that is that on that particular partial how to calculate partial pressure if it is not given. Now let's take a look at an example. Example one, what is the partial pressure of oxygen gas collected over water at standard atmospheric pressure, at standard atmospheric pressure and then 25 degree centigrade. Now if the saturated vapor pressure of water is 23 millimeter mercury. Now the question here is, we are given the P total because they said at standard temperature and standard pressure. Our standard pressure, we all know, is 760 millimeter mercury, 1.01 times 10 raised to power 5 newton per meter square, or 1 atm, depending on the one you are going to use depends on the question, the unit you are given in the equation. Our unit here is millimeter mercury, so therefore we are going to use 760 millimeter mercury as our total pressure. Our partial pressure of oxygen is what we are looking for, while the vapor pressure of water at why the partial pressure of water, which is the vapor pressure, is saturated vapor pressure is 23 millimeter mercury. Now the question is, what is saturated vapor pressure? Saturated vapor pressure is the pressure exerted by a vapor when it is in equilibrium with a liquid. When we have a vapor, which is a gas, in equilibrium with liquid, the pressure exerted by that vapor is known as the saturated vapor pressure. Now, according to our explanation, we have our P oxygen, which is the P gas, is going to be the P total, which is the total pressure, minus the partial pressure of the water vapor. And that is, we have 760 minus 23, the answer is equal to 737 millimeter mercury, which is the partial pressure of oxygen according to the question. So that is that on that question. Now let's look at question two. A mixture of gases contains 64 gram of ammonia, 70 gram of nitrogen exerts a pressure of 1.8 atmosphere. What is the partial pressure exerted by ammonia in the mixture? We are given the atomic mass of hydrogen to be 1, that of nitrogen to be 14. Now, solution. First of all, we are not given, if you look at this, we are not given the number of moles, but we have a relation between number of moles and then mass. If you remember in our previous lessons in our class, we say number of moles is equal to mass all over molar mass. So we can calculate our the molar mass of ammonia there, which is calculated there as 14 plus 1 times 3, because hydrogen has the atomic mass of 1 multiplied by 3. Yeah, because we have 3 hydrogen there, which is equal to 17 gram per mole. That is the molar mass of ammonia. That of nitrogen is N2, because nitrogen is a diatomic gas. So 14 is the atomic mass multiplied by 2, which is 28 gram per mole. Now you cannot calculate the number of moles of ammonia, which is going to be mass all over molar mass, 64 gram all over 17 gram per mole. If you calculate it very well, you are going to have 3.76 moles. Now the same thing, you calculate that of nitrogen, 70 gram all over 28 gram, you are going to have 2.5 mole. And then total number of moles will now be number of moles of ammonia plus that of number of moles of nitrogen, which will be equal to 6.36 mole. Then now you cannot calculate the partial pressure of ammonia, which is the mole fraction multiplied by the P total. Now it's going to be number of moles of ammonia all over the total number of moles multiplied by the total pressure, which will now be 1.08 atmosphere. So that is that on that. And then we move to the next example. Our next example is, a certain mass of hydrogen gas was collected over water at 6 degrees centigrade and then 765 millimeter mercury pressure as a volume of 35. Calculate the volume when it is dry at STP. We are given our saturated vapor pressure of water to be at 6 degrees centigrade to be 7 millimeter mercury. First of all, we calculate what the partial pressure of hydrogen, which the partial pressure of hydrogen will be the P total minus the partial pressure of water vapor, and there we have 758 millimeter mercury. If you look at this question very well, calculate at STP, that is the standard temperature and the pressure. Like I said, you normally you bring your terms together, because each of these steps has their own mark. In order to get your full mark, you have to work step by step. Bring out your terms there. If you see this gas law, they are linked together. If you look at this question very well, by the time you bring out your, because they say calculate the volume now, by the time you bring out your terms, you will see that the correct formula we are going to apply is that of the general gas equation. That is P1 over V1 all over T1 is equals to P2 V2 all over V2. You make V2 the subject of the formula, and then you have your calculations as follow. At standard temperature and pressure, that means your P2 will be 760 millimeter mercury. They say at standard temperature and pressure. And your V2 is what you are looking for. And then your T2 will now be 273 Kelvin, which is the standard temperature. Now, if you do your calculation very well, and you do your cancellation of your units very well, using the general gas equation and making V2 the subject of the formula, you are going to have 34.2 cm³. That is our final answer. Now, that is that on the Dalton's law of partial pressure. That is Dalton, Dalton law of partial pressure. We are going to move on to now to Graham's law of diffusion of gases. Now, the law states that at constant temperature and pressure, the rate of diffusion of gases is inversely proportional to the square root of the density, to the square root of its vapor density. Let's look at some things here. What is vapor density? Vapor density is the number of time a given volume of a gas is heavier than the same volume of hydrogen gas at constant temperature and pressure. That is what vapor density is. Now, we know gases diffuse at the fast rate, and that is why when you spread a perfume, in a very short period of time, people from a far distance from you, we can smell the odor. The same thing, the exhaust from a car, that is the smoke from a car, you see when the combs come out, as it gradually disappear at what? It gradually disappears after the sun. This is a result of the movement of this gas molecule. Now, and the process is known as diffusion. This diffusion process is as a result of this the zigzag movement of this gas molecule. Now, we are bringing another time. Now, what is diffusion? As we all know, diffusion is the movement of gas molecule from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. That is what diffusion is. There is another term we use, which is called effusion. Effusion is the movement of gas molecule through a small opening. That is what is known as effusion. Now, that is that. Now, what is this? Using kinetic energy, using kinetic theory to explain this, the movement of this gas molecule. Now, at constant temperature and pressure, the average kinetic energy of a gas molecule, at constant temperature, the average kinetic energy is also constant. Because what? Because it is dependent on the temperature. Now, the gases with lower density or lower relative molecular mass will diffuse faster than those ones with higher relative molecular mass. For example, when we have two people with the same energy, the same everything, and you ask them to push a truck. Let's say the truck, the first person was given a truck with a load of 50 grams, and the second person was given a barrel with a load of 50 grams, and the second person was also given a barrel with a load of 100 grams. They all have equal energy. Who do you think will move faster? Is that person with the load of 50 grams? Because the load is more lighter than the person with a load of what? Of 100 grams. So the lighter the relative molecular mass of a particular gas, the faster the rate at which they will move. Now, that is that on that. Now, another thing we are going to look at now is this. When we have two gases now, we said the rate is directly, the rate of diffusion of this gas is directly proportional to the square root of the vapor density. Sorry, it's not directly. it said that the rate at the rate of diffusion of this gas is inversely proportional to the square root. That means the lighter the relative molecular mass, the faster the rate of at which the gas will move, and then vice versa. Now, having known that the rate is inversely proportional to the square root of the density is also directly proportional to the relative molecular mass of the gas. But the vapor, the density is half of the molecular mass. We are still coming to that. Now, if we have two gases, like we said, we have gas R1. If we have two gases, R1 will be K all over square root of D1, which is the density, and R2 square root of D2. Now, if we are removing the proportionality constant, here we have R is equals to if we are removing the proportionality constant, that is when the K will come in, which is the constant. And for two gases, we have R1 to be K all over square root of D1, R2 to be square root to be K all over square root of D2. Now, R1 all over R2, when you divide them, you are going to, at the end of the day, you have R1 all over R2 is equal to the square root of D2 all over the square root of D1, which is equation one. Now, I said, if you remember, I said vapor density is equals to molar mass divided by 2. I said they have a relationship with them. They are directly proportional to each other. Vapor density is equals to molar mass divided by 2, while molar mass is equals to vapor density times 2. So each of the one that is given to you, you can calculate the other one there. And then when we replace the vapor density, when it is replaced by the molar mass, we still have our R1 over R2 is equals to, this time around is going to be square root of M2 over 2 all over square root of M1 over 1. Now, when you rearrange and then you cancel out 2, you have R1 over R2 is equals to the square root of M2 all over M1. Now, when we are relating rates, we are looking at it in terms of what? In terms of time. If for two gases, the volume and the distance are the same, then the rate will be inversely proportional to the time. Why? Because the faster the rate of reaction, the smaller the time, the faster the rate of diffusion, the smaller the time it takes to diffuse. Now, in terms of time, we have R, that is rate of diffusion, is inversely proportional to time. Removing the proportionality constants, we are going to have V all over, R is equals to V divided by 2, where V is our proportionality constant. When we have two gases, R1 and R2, we are going to have R1 is equals to V all over T1, then R2 is going to be V all over T2, and then our R1 over R2 will have V all over T1 divided by V all over T2. Now, rearranging and cancelling out V, we are going to have our R1 all over R2 to be what? T2 all over T1. That is our equation 3. That is our equation 3. Now, if we are combining equation 2 and 3, we are going to have our T1 over T2 is equal to square root of M2 all over square root of M1. So that is that on that. Now, let's take some calculations. Example 1. Calculate the vapor density of a triatomic gas, S, if its relative atomic mass is 16. A triatomic gas is a gas that has three atoms of that gas. It has three atoms of S. So it's going to be one mole of S is going to be S3. And we are given the relative molecular mass of X. So it's going to be, which is 16, it's going to be 16 times 3, which is equals to 48. But remember, we are asked to calculate the vapor density. If you remember, our vapor density is equal to the relative molecular mass divided by 2. And then you have you have 24 as the relative. There you have 24 as the vapor density of that gas R. Now, we move to another question. We are given that the density of two gases A and B are 0.25 gram per dm cube and 1.0 gram per dm cube respectively. What is the rate of the diffusion of A relative to B? If you look at their density, if you look at the question very well, A has a density of 0.25 and the other one has a density, that is B, has a density of 1. Even before the calculation, we will know that A will diffuse faster than B. Now, let's do our calculation and see. Density, we have that. If we, the formula that we are to apply is going to be rate R1 all over R2, that is RA all over RB, is equals to the square root of DB all over the square root of DA. Now, it's going to be the square root of 1 all over 0.25. Now, when you square them, we are going to have our RA all over RB is equals to square root of 1 is 1, square root of 0.25 is 0.5. And then when you multiply both sides, because we have a fraction there, we multiply by 2, then you have our R1, RA and RB to be 2 all over 1. That means gas A diffuses twice more than gas R. That is faster more than gas B. So that is that on that question. Now, example, another example here. I took my time to solve many examples that relate to this question so that you can understand it better. Another example is 50 cm cube of oxygen diffuses through a porous plug in 10 seconds. How long will it take 100 cm cube of methane to diffuse through the same plug under the same condition? We are given the atomic mass of hydrogen 1, carbon 12, oxygen 16. Now, solving this question, we have to calculate our rates because we are not given the rate. And we know rate has a relationship, which is R is equals to V over T. So it's going to be R, that is the rate of oxygen gas is equals to volume of oxygen all over time of oxygen, which is 50 cm cube all over 10, which is 5 centimeter cube per second. Now, for methane, CH4, the rate will be the same thing. But this time around, we are not giving the time. It is the time that we are to calculate. So we have 100 all over T, which is the same, which is going to be 100 over T centimeter cube. But now, the next formula we are going to apply is the R oxygen, that is R oxygen all over rate of oxygen all over rate of diffusion of our meeting is going to be the square root the square root of the molar mass of our methane all over that of the oxygen. Now calculating the molar mass of methane, we have one carbon and then four hydrogen, so it's going to be 16 gram per mole, and that of oxygen will be when you calculate it very well, oxygen is a diatomic gas, O2, 16 times 2, it's going to be 32 gram per mole. So that is that. Now, applying our formula, we know that the rate of oxygen is 5 cm cubed, that of methane is 100 over T is equals to square root of 16, which is the square root of oxygen, which is the molar mass of oxygen all over square root of methane, which is 16, all over the square root of oxygen, which is 32. Now, 16 we divide 32. 16 in 16 is 1. 16 in 32 is 2. So we are going to have 5 all over 100 over T is equals to square root of 1 over 2. Now, squaring both sides, if you square both sides, we have 5 times 5, which is 25. Then T times T is T squared. 100 times 100 is going to be 10,000. Then the square root, the square, we remove the square root, and it will be is equals to 1 over 2. That is 25 T squared all over 10,000 is equals to 1 over Now, when you divide 25 divided by 10,000, you are going to have 1 over 400. So 1 times T squared is going to be T squared. So it's going to be T squared over 400 is equals to 1 over 2. Now, dividing both sides, if you cross multiply, you cross multiply. When you cross multiply, you are going to have 2t squared is equals to 400, because it's going to be 2 times t squared is equals to 400 times 1. So it's going to be 2t squared all over 400. Now divide both sides by 2, we have t squared is equals to 200, and t will be equal to square root of 200, which is equal in which t will be equal to 4.1 seconds. So that is that for that particular question. Now the last question: if it takes 20 seconds for 100 centimeter cube of oxygen to pass through a partition, and it takes the same volume of gas as 2.5 seconds to pass through the same partition, what is the relative molecular mass of S? Now, here we are going to look at the relation that relates time and mass together, and that is T2 over T1 is equals to the square root of M2 all over the square root of M1. Now, we have T of oxygen all over TS is equals to the square root of what? The relative molecular mass of oxygen all over that of gas S. Like I normally tell you, any work you are doing, just bring out your terms. Number one, it will assist you. You equally have a mark for that, and then it will assist you in knowing the type of a formula that you are to apply for a particular question. Now, inserting this formula, we have 20 all over 2.5 is equals to square root of 32 all over x. Now, cross multiply, you have 20 times square root of x is equals to 2.5 times square root of 32. You divide both sides by 20 to make square root of x the subject of the formula. And you are going to have square root of x is equals to 1 all over square root of 32 divided by 8. So that is that. Now, squaring both sides, because we want to remove the square root, the square will remove the square root, and then when you square the other side, you have s is equals to 1 times 32, because the square will remove that of square root on 32, and 8 square root of 8 is 64. So you have s is equals to 1 times 32 all over 64. Now, 32 divided by 32, we have 1. 64 divided by 32, we have 2. So s is equals to 1 over 2, which is equals to 0.5, which is approximately 1. So that is your assignment on the board. You have seen your assignment very well now. And then please ensure you do your assignment. Apart from your assignment, also do some exercises under this particular gas law. The more you practice this exercise, the more you understand it better. And then please, I want to remind you, when you are answering my question, I would prefer you solve it in your booklet, your notebook, you snap it and then upload it so that I can see it better. For those of you that attempted my questions under Boyle's law, yes, I made a comment there. The last question there, you have to apply the formula. If you look at your notes very well, there's an example there that clarified that. So you should use that P1V1 is equals to P2V2 to solve that particular question. Not just telling me. I want to see the calculation on now, whether it is double or triple. I want to see that calculation. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. This is